Hello students, welcome back to my channel. My name is Jagdeep. In this video series, we are talking about indifference curve analysis for the advanced segment. In our previous video, we learned about Slutsky's substitution effect and how it is different from the Hicksian substitution effect. As promised in the previous video, this video shall focus upon the diagrammatic representation of the Slutsky's substitution effect, and I'll supplement a numerical example along with the diagram so that it makes understanding more easier and you get the logical reasoning as to why Slutsky's substitution effect differs from the one given by Hicks. Alright, so without wasting any time further, let's get started. So just to give you a brief introduction about what substitution effect given by Slutsky was, so if you've seen the previous video, you could see the same slide again. I'll just briefly skim through it. So Slutsky's substitution effect basically focuses upon how the income of consumer could be reduced so that consumer is able to purchase his initial combination of the goods if he chooses to. And I had mentioned in the previous video that we'll take a look at this segment once we diagrammatically represent it. All right. So let us take a look at how the diagrammatic representation of Slutsky's substitution effect looks like. So all those who have seen the video previous to this know that the substitution effect given by Slutsky is done through something called as cost difference. I've given one formula in the previous video. In this video, I'm giving this another formula which will help you to identify the amount of income, the monetary income of consumer to be reduced. All right. Now, why is the income getting reduced is something that we will take a look at right now. So we'll begin with a numerical example first and then we will take a look at how it is diagrammatically represented. Okay, so let us say a consumer has money income equal to $25, all right, and he is spending this money income on two commodities. One is good X and the other one is good Y. All right, now the price of good X is $2 and price of good Y is $3. Now consumer purchases, let me write it like this, this is commodity X and this is commodity Y. So how many units is the consumer buying of commodity X and commodity Y? He's buying 5 units of both. Okay, 5 units of both. And what is the expense that he incurs? So 5 units times 2, that makes it $10 for commodity X, and 5 units times 3, that makes it $15 for commodity Y, and they both add up to $25, which is the money income of the consumer. So we are aware that the consumer is now spending all of his income on two commodities, which is X and Y, and he is buying 5 units of each of them. That's our scenario. All right. Now, if the price of commodity X falls, all right, and it goes down to $1, that's a $1 reduction in the price of commodity X. It was initially priced at $2. Now it is priced at $1. All right. So now when the price of commodity X falls to $1, what happens? Consumers, real income increases. Why is the real income increasing? Because in the same $10 expense that he was incurring to buy commodity X, now he'll be able to buy a larger quantity than 5, right? So in $10, now a larger quantity of good X can be purchased. We certainly don't want this to happen. So we will reduce the income of the consumer. So now we will focus upon the substitution effect given by Slutsky. What does Slutsky say? He says that consumer should be able to buy the same quantity of goods even after the changes in prices. So to enable the consumer to purchase the same quantity of good X and good Y, what do we need to do? His money income needs to be reduced. Why? To keep his real income constant. Good X was 5 units and good Y was also 5 units. So now at $1, consumer is buying 5 units, spending $5. Likewise, there's no change in the price of commodity Y, so he is still spending the same 15 bucks, that is $3 for 5 units, that is $15. So consumer would be spending a total of $20. But his money income was $25. That means his money income needs to be reduced by $5 so that he's able to spend $20 and buy the same combination of goods as he was buying on equilibrium point E. Clear? Now let us see how would this look like on a diagram. This is the y-axis, this is the x-axis. All right, let me label these things. So we have good Y on the y-axis, good X on the x-axis. This is the initial budget line. Let me name it as AB. And let us say this is the initial indifference curve and this is the point of equilibrium. This is the quantity of commodity X purchased by the consumer. Now, when price of commodity X falls, what will happen to the budget line? The budget line rotates outwards on X axis, right? So let's rotate the budget line. So let us say this is AB1, all right? Now, whenever the budget line is rotating outwards like this, it indicates an increase in the real income. And to avoid a consumer buying more than what he was buying initially, his money income has to be reduced so that the real income remains at this level, which is OB. Okay? Now, if we compare Slutsky's substitution effect with Hicksian substitution effect, they both require a reduction in the income of the consumer so that the real income is kept constant. The only difference was, under Hicksian substitution effect, we did not know by how much the money income needs to be reduced, right? No knowledge about how much money income has to be reduced. But when we talk about Slutsky's substitution effect, we know that the income of the consumer needs to go down, the money income needs to go down by $5. When we do that, when the money income of the consumer is reduced, we know what will happen. The budget line shifts downwards parallel to the initial budget line, all right? So it will move this way, the one in green arrows. So let us shift the budget line. Now, how do we draw the budget line? If we remember, when we were drawing Hicksian substitution effect, we were drawing the budget line in such a way that it was tangent, it was parallelly shift downwards and tangent to the initial indifference curve, somewhat like this. Now, since the consumer is buying the same combination, the budget line would now shift downwards in such a way that it crosses through this point of equilibrium, ensuring that the consumer is getting an option to buy the same combination of goods that he was buying at the initial equilibrium. All right, so let's draw the budget line. Let's bring it down and parallel to AB1. The budget line that I have drawn is not parallel, mind it. You will have to draw the budget line parallel to the new budget line in this case. So with pen, paper, scales, it will be easier for you to draw this. On the iPad, it is very difficult to get the drawing correct. So this is a new budget line. Let me name it as LM. All right. I'm repeating again. Make sure when you, if you're drawing it along with me, this budget line should be parallel. It is not parallel in my diagram. Okay. Now, if we see this, the budget line LM goes through this point E, right? That means the consumer has the option to buy OQ quantity of commodity X. But if we remember the equilibrium conditions, so consumer equilibrium is at a point where indifference curve is tangent to the budget line. But at point E, do we see that tangency? No, we don't see that tangency. That means the consumer is not feeling maximum satisfaction at this point on the budget line LM, right? So let me point it out over here. I'll use the same green shade so that you know which point am I referring to. So here, satisfaction is not maximum at point E on budget line LM. Why is it not maximum? Because the consumer equilibrium situation or condition is not met. To get maximum satisfaction, this consumer will now move to a higher indifference curve. So to maximize his or her satisfaction level, or as we say, utility, consumer will move on another indifference curve. Let us plot that new indifference curve. Let us say this is the new indifference curve IC1, and this is the new point of equilibrium E1. At point E1. Now, what is happening at point E1? So, at E1, quantity of X has increased, whereas quantity of Y has been decreased. So what is happening? Consumer has substituted the cheaper commodity here, which is commodity X, and has increased his purchase from Q to Q1 and has decreased his purchasing of commodity Y, which is a relatively expensive commodity. So this is how, under Slutsky's substitution effect, a consumer will generally attain equilibrium at a higher indifference curve, indicating that the consumer is certainly better off than before. So if he chooses to, he can still buy E, but that won't maximize his satisfaction. As a rational individual, a consumer would always prefer to be on point E1 on a higher indifference curve, which is IC1. I hope you've understood the concept of Slutsky's substitution effect. In the next video, we'll take a look at the opposite scenario, which is a rise in the price of a commodity, and see how it could be diagrammatically represented. Students, if you find my videos useful and helpful, please subscribe to my channel and share my videos. If you find learning through long videos daunting, follow my Instagram channel and learn through Reels. I'll be releasing the notes very soon. And for that, you need to follow me on my Facebook page, because that's where I'll be releasing the notes for this entire series. So I'll meet you in the next video with another segment of Slutsky's substitution effect. Bye now. Take care.